My name is Neil Gilbert. I am your host today. I am the market strategist here at GFT Markets and FX360.com. You can find me under the Twitter handle at FX Examiner. I am also on Facebook as well, just FX Examiner there. And I have special guest with me today, Matt Weller, who is our technical strategist here. And you can find him under the Twitter handle at MWellerFX. You're on Facebook too, aren't you?
Yes.
Yes.
I think. I don't know. Maybe. It's under Matt Weller. I tend to use Twitter for most of my communication.
Okay, good deal. So, anyway, at MLRFX if you guys want to follow him on Twitter. Reason that we're here today is to cover the Stutter Step Trade Tutorial. This is one of the reasons that I do have Matt with us here today. For those who aren't aware, that is a picture of Matt with his fiance.
No, that's
okay.
Not me.
That's not Matt then, so never mind. He does not look like that at all. My esteemed colleague Matt Weller is about to ingratiate us with his brilliance as he forays into the melodiousness of his stutter step trade methodology. So without further ado, Matt?
All right. Thank you for that introduction and coverage of the news there, Neil. And personally, just to provide a little bit of background here, maybe it could be applied to dance. I'm personally a guy, so I was more focused on the sports implications of the stutter step when applying it here. But basically, the idea behind this trading strategy is it's not something where I came up with this analogy and tried to say, okay, well, can I trade it? But it's actually something that's been very commonly used throughout the market where you'll see a market that's trending very strongly, and then it'll pause briefly, and that pause, just like in sports, maybe in dance too, is what's called a stutter step move, where a dancer or an athlete moving quickly in one direction just pauses.
In sports,
the idea is to try to throw off the defender and wrong foot them. Maybe in dance, they might just do it because it looks cool, but regardless, and then you'll often see the athlete take off again in the same direction. That analogy can be applied to the market, where we'll see a strong move in one direction, a brief pause, and then we'll be looking for that next move back in the same direction. That can really provide a lower risk, higher reward trading strategy.
So let's get
into how we actually identify this trade.
One of the big
reasons why I like this trade so much is because it's very simple. You're basically looking for a combination of two candlesticks. If you're not familiar with these candlesticks, feel free to ask questions as they occur. But basically,
We're first
looking for a marubozu candle. That's a complicated Japanese word for a candlestick that doesn't have
wicks or
tails on the candle. This is a pretty good example here that I've drawn in green, where you can see pretty much the whole body of the candle. So if we say this is a one-hour candle, over that whole hour, we've seen pretty consistent buying pressure because it's a green candle. So we started down here, didn't really move lower. In fact, consistently moved higher throughout the candle and finished near the top.
This
candlestick, as you might imagine after that description, shows strong buying or selling pressure. It is often followed by a very brief profit-taking candle or a brief pause near the extreme, but then it tends to continue in the same direction. That's that stutter step analogy. So what we're looking for, and I'll get you here in a second, Neil, if you had a question. So we're just looking for that large marubozu candle followed by a small inside candle, so one that's completely within the body of that marubozu candle, and we'll provide a little bit more color on that momentarily.
Neil?
Okay, so obviously one of the benefits that I have here of sitting here and just talking to Matt and kind of looking at him and saying, hey, I have a question, is obviously the speed with which to do that. And one of the questions I always have on marubozu candles, and perhaps some of the other people out here have this same question, is with the wicks on these candlesticks, the big marubozu candle, now I notice the wicks are very small. Is there any kind of a definition as far as saying, okay, well, this wick is too big for this to be a marubozu candle or something along those lines? Do you use those kinds of that kind of thought process in order to be able to disqualify certain candles like that?
I personally don't extensively, but I think that's a great thing to do when you're starting out. So it's getting into a little bit of the mechanics of it. But for instance, I've seen traders say for it to be a valid marubozu candle,
about 10% here. Between, for instance, this would be the open and the low, so a 10% of the overall size of the candle as the size of that tail, and 10% on the top. So maybe if you're starting out, if you're not comfortable with the idea of looking for them, maybe you want to apply some rule like that. So that way, 80% of the body of the candle is a marubozu, is showing strong trading pressure. At this point, though, and this is something that hopefully we're trying to help all of you guys reach this level, but this is just a framework. Once you understand why we're looking at this strategy, why we're looking for strong buying and selling pressure. That's where you can start to apply these principles. If you attend my regular live market analysis webinars, you know there's times where I'll bend some of these rules. For instance, the second candle might not be quite a full inside candle. It might peak above here a little bit. But basically, it's showing that same principle, a big move in one direction, then a pause, and then we're looking to catch the extension, a move back in that same direction once again. So if you want a rule of thumb, I've heard 10% on the top and bottom as a maximum, just so it's a valid Mauro Bozu candle. But hopefully by the end of this presentation, you'll understand the thought process behind it and be able to apply it in your
about own about trading in that way.
Perfect, Matt. Thank you very much for that.
Yep, no worries. That's
further questions?
Okay, so yeah, a little bit of an echo. That might be my fault. You're on it. Cool. So anyway, just to wrap up this introduction here, a break of the Mauro Bozu higher low, in this case we see a bullish Mauro Bozu candle that shows us buying pressure, so we're looking for a break above the high. That's usually a good signal that the trend is resuming and that the market's starting to take back off in the same direction. So these are basically the tools that we look for when identifying buy trades. As we already talked about, we want to identify a bullish Mauro Bozu candle. This is actually a couple of slides that I used a few months ago for a presentation I did where it was more of a longer term presentation. So I highlighted using it on the 4-hour chart. Personally, I found that this strategy works very well on a number of different charts. I think by the end of today's presentation, we'll have a chance to outline a trade on a daily chart, so even longer term. But it's the same principles. We're looking for a strong move, then that pause, and the next move in the same direction. One good filter, kind of like using that 10% tail rule to identify a Mauro Bozu candle, is that we actually want to see strong buying and selling pressure. The types of moves that we've seen so far this week, for example, very quiet markets, maybe there was a Mauro Bozu candle on the 1-hour chart, but it might have only been 15 pips on the euro dollar or something like that. It's not showing strong buying and selling pressure. It's just a coincidence where it happened not to have many tails over the course of that hour. So a good filter you can use to try to find valid trades is to look at the ATR, or the average true range, and the default setting for that is 14 periods. So what the heck is the average true range, you might be wondering? It's a tool that basically says how big on average were the last candles. So if the last 14 candles were all 20 pips large on a 1-hour chart, well then the average true range of all those 20 pip candles is 20 pips, and obviously they're going to vary a lot more than that, but it's basically saying on average, how much has the market moved over this time period? And we're looking for a bigger than average move because that's where we can really start to see more momentum and a higher probability trade. Yep, so got a follow-up question here, and this is definitely a good one. The question is, does it have to be a 4-hour candle? Is it more reliable on a 4-hour candle? Those are great questions. In this case, I would say that it does not have to be a 4-hour candle. Like I said, we're going to talk about one at the end of the presentation on the daily chart. I personally like looking for this strategy now more so on a 1-hour chart, just because it obviously the candle's complete 4 times more often. That means there's 4 times as many trade opportunities. So it's a great strategy because you can really adjust it to your preferred time frame. If you're someone who only likes to be into trades a couple of hours, maybe you want to look for this setup on a 15-minute chart. But to answer the second part of your question, as a good rule of thumb with just about any strategy, it tends to become more reliable and more effective on the longer term chart. So hopping up from a 1-hour to a 4-hour chart, you're going to find slightly more reliable signals, at least in my experience, and the same thing with the hop from the 4-hour to the daily, but you're going to find fewer of those signals. So it's all about finding sort of that comfort zone for you where you feel like a signal's valid, but you still have enough signals to keep trading interesting and hopefully profitable for you. So good question there. We'll walk through examples, I think, on both the 4 and 1 hour chart and also on a daily chart coming up. All right, and then Bobby Kier, how can you explain how best to identify ATR? It's just an indicator that you can add to your charts easily. It will show how to do that when we get into the charts, but you just pull it up, the default settings 14, and that'll show you on average how big the last 14 candles were, which I just use as a filter. All right, so just to wrap up with a few more of these rules here, we want to wait for at least one inside candle to form, and this is the important part in the upper half of the Mauro Bozu candle when we're looking for those buy trades. We're looking for consolidation, but if we start to see an inside candle retracing most of that big move up, that's where it becomes more of a two-way balance trade situation. It's almost like that athlete or that dancer running 10 meters in one direction and then running back 8 meters. Well, that doesn't show that he's moving forward strongly. We're looking for a quick 10-meter run, then a pause, and then a takeoff in that same direction. So as long as it's in the upper half, that's valid for me to trade, and we'll walk through some examples again. Just a couple more follow-ups as far as specifically entering the orders. And these ones are specifically tailored to the 4-hour chart. If you're jumping down to a 1-hour chart, maybe you want to nudge this down to 3 pips or make an appropriate amount for if you're trading gold or oil or a commodity, and we'll talk about some of those. But as a good rule of thumb, if you identify a stutter step trade on a 4-hour chart, I like to use a stop buy order 5 pips above the high of the Marubozu candle, at least assuming you're trading a major currency pair, euro, dollar, pound, dollar, dollar yen, Aussie dollar, even euro pound or something like that. So we're looking to buy if we break out above that high. The great part about this trade is that you can have a tight stop loss. As a rule of thumb on the 4-hour chart, I just look for 5 pips below the inside candle low. So it's probably still going to be in the upper half of that Marubozu candle. And the most subjective part about the trade is the target. We're looking to set the target below the next level of resistance. And however you want to determine resistance, anything you found valid there can work. When I'm explaining this strategy, I like to go as simple as possible. So I'll just look at the next level of previous resistance where we saw a high emerge in the past and use that as a possible target. And I think this will really become a lot more clear when we walk through some examples. As long as you can get a 1-to-1 reward to risk ratio, if you have 40 pips on your stop loss, you're looking for at least 40 pips of your reward. I found that this tends to be a higher probability trade. So even if you win that style of trade, say 55% of the time, 60% of the time, you can come out on top. You don't need a particularly strong reward to risk ratio because you already know where the momentum is and how strongly the market's moving. So before I jump into an example, looks like we had a question here from Deepak. Does it always work on bullish candle or bearish also? I believe by the formulation of your question, you're asking, can we also trade it with bearish candles? And the answer is yes, and we'll walk through some of those. But it certainly doesn't always work on any style of candle, and that's why we always want to have that stop loss in case the market reverses. So good question, and we'll get into the rules for a bearish candle momentarily. All right, so let's see an actual example. Rather than that block of text here, I think this really goes a lot further to explain it. So this is an example on a 4-hour chart of the Australian dollar versus the US dollar. Here we can see strong buying pressure. I don't know if this candle specifically would fall within that example we talked about earlier with 10% tails, but it's basically pretty clear at this point that we're seeing strong buying pressure. The market's moved up quite a bit in a short period of time. This is looks like in excess of 100 pip candle here. I didn't put the ATR on. We can walk through some more examples of that when we get into a deal book, but again, we're seeing that big bullish candle here, and then we put in back to back small inside candles. That's showing us the market's tipped its hand. It's saying the buyers are in control. They took a pause here for these 2 4-hour candles over this 8-hour time period. But even though the buyers weren't pushing the market up anymore, it's not like the sellers took the baton and pushed us back down. In fact, we really just saw consolidation at the top of the range. And that's where we were able to set up this trade. And you'll notice that with these 2 inside candles, you basically had 8 hours to set up this trade in advance and prepare for that breakout. Here we're looking to stop buy if the market keeps going in our direction. Stop loss down at 0048. Notice that's below the low of the inside candle. It gives us a relatively small amount of risk here, only about 50 pips on a trade on a 4-hour chart is decent. And we look to set the target just ahead of that next area of resistance, giving us about 60 pips of reward. So it's a little bit better than 1-to-1 on the reward to risk ratio. And overall, obviously, I went through my charts and picked out a good example, but this is a great example of the trade. So this is something I would feel confident trading if it were emerging in the market right now, for example. So let's see how this trade worked out. You can see as I move forward to my next slide, we got a burst higher on the next 4-hour candle. Strong move up. Our buy triggered here at right about at 101 and saw a consistent move toward 101.55 next. So we were able to quickly take out our profit on the trade. Looks like the market moved higher. Maybe if you're comfortable adjusting trades while they're live, that's something you can try to capture in the future. But just for the example of this, it was a great trade to take profits ahead of this resistance area. Even though we broke through, we were still able to book some profits on a trade that had a good risk-to-reward ratio and what I think is more important is a higher probability trade because we were able to identify this setup. So we're going to walk through one or two more examples, but there's a question here from the chat box. The question here is, isn't that a tweezer top pattern, i.e. something where you might want to consider waiting and seeing? And this is what I really like about this strategy. It's a great question. Maybe this pause in the market is something that has you unsettled. But the key here is that we are waiting and seeing. This is why we use a stop buy. I don't just automatically buy when we see that inside candle. This, by using a stop buy, we're saying only if we start to break out in the same direction. Maybe we do go up, pause, form these two inside candles, and then start to reverse back lower. But in that case, we never would have got into our buy trade. We only get in when we break out to a new high, and that's what I think really can make this a higher probability strategy. Did you have anything to add there, Neil?
Well, I think it's important to note here as well the risk-to-reward ratio as well here, because you have your next level of resistance, you know, where that where that price high happened to come into play. Now, if that high was actually a little bit lower, so therefore perhaps the target wasn't necessarily as big as the stop, you probably wouldn't enter that trade. Am I correct?
Right. Yeah, that's a great example, Neil. So
you'll recall the last rule on our rules page was that we want to look for at least a 1-to-1 reward to risk ratio, and that is one that I stick to religiously because to me it makes the math easy. If we know where the momentum is right now and if we start to get a breakout, it's not going to work every time. But in the long run, the probability should be in your favor. So if you have that 1-to-1 risk-to-reward ratio and you win 50% of the time, then you're breaking even. If you can win more than that, then that's where it starts to fall in your favor. If you start to look at negative risk-to-reward ratios where you might have 40 pips of reward compared to 50 pips of risk, that's where it's a little bit more questionable because you have to win, in that example, 60% of your trades or so just to break even. So it kind of eliminates the higher probability nature of the trade. So we're always looking for that 1-to-1 risk-to-reward ratio. If that high was down here at 101.20, well, then clearly the risk-to-reward ratio wouldn't be worth it, and that would probably be an example where I'd pass on the trade, even though we identified the price action that was supporting it. The way the target and stop loss worked out, it wouldn't have been appropriate. All right, so this is a good question. I think this is one that a lot of traders have. The question is basically on the idea of when to use a stop buy or a limit buy to get into a trade. The best way I've heard of to visualize it is using a stop order to get in on a breakout. Here we're looking for a breakout above resistance. We don't want to get in unless we break this Marubozu candle high, and that's where we would determine that the momentum's in our favor and we'd want to buy it. It's the same idea with a stop sell where we're looking for a break below support. If, and this isn't something we do in this strategy, but if you're waiting for a move more in your favor, maybe one of the first things you learned about trading was that you want to buy low and sell high. That's when you'd want to use a limit order. If you're looking to buy lower than the current market price or sell higher than the current market price, that's when you're going to use a limit order. In the case of stop orders, it's almost like you're buying high, you're buying at a higher price, but then you're looking to sell even higher, and that can be a valid strategy as well. It's just different ways to go about trading. Certain traders like to wait for pullbacks, wait for the market to move and give them a better price first. That would be a trader who might use a lot of limit buys and sells to get into trades. Whereas in this example, this is a momentum-driven trade, so we might use a stop buy or a stop sell order, as you'll see momentarily. All right, so one more question here from Murtaza, and this is a good question. I think a lot of these will become clear as we get through more examples. But the question is, do you have to wait for the little red candle, or can you buy above the big green candle? Where would the stop be if no red candle? That's a great question, Murtaza, and I feel like you're kind of teaching the strategy for me. The whole reason that I like this strategy is that it can give you that good risk-to-reward ratio if we know where to set our stop. But if we don't see that pause, don't see that inside candle form first, then we wouldn't know where to set up the stop loss and couldn't determine the risk-to-reward ratio. So that's why we want to see that inside candle first, that pause in momentum, because that can really clear the way for the next move higher. If you can almost look ahead to this next example, obviously when this 4-hour candle finished that took us to our target, that's another bullish Marubozu candle, but you wouldn't necessarily want to buy here. One, because we're testing possible resistance from the 102 area, and because we haven't seen that pause, there's no obvious area to set up your stop loss, and thus you couldn't have a good way of determining a valid risk-to-reward ratio. Did you want to I saw you scribbling up a diagram that
I've seen there used a lot too, Neil. So if you want to share that.
Well, just to kind of piggyback on what you told Bobic there on the using limit buys, the stop buys, and all that kind of stuff. One of the things that helped me out, especially when I was newer into trading and didn't quite wrap my head around the whole concept, was using a diagram. And I'm just going to share my screen here with you real quick. If you guys could just grab a piece of paper for all those that have a hard time doing this, and completely, I understand it. I had this up at my desk for a long time, is to use this kind of a concept, you know, where we have the market set, you know, and I just basically draw a market on a piece of paper. And therefore, when I want to place orders, I basically say, okay, well, I want to sell above current market price. What does that mean? Well, that means I have to enter into a limit order, because the market has to rally up to a certain point before I start selling at that point, because I think there's going to be resistance there, something along those lines. That actually has to be a limit order. However, if you are buying into that rally, or you're buying with that rally, basically you have to use a stop loss, or a stop order, not a stop loss. So basically, if you are setting up an entry above market price and selling, it is a limit order. If you're selling, or if you're setting up an entry above current market price that's a buy order, it's a stop. It's just the opposite if you're doing below market price. So if you are selling with a drop in the market that is set up below the market, it is a stop sell. And then if you think that the markets are going to find a level of support and you want to buy at that level, it is a limit buy. So this is just kind of a diagram that I had set up that helped me in kind of comprehending this whole thing, is to just write market on a piece of paper, write limit sell above it, stop buy above it, and then write stop sell below it and limit buy below it. So hopefully that actually helps out. I know it's real simplification of the whole thing, but that helped me out a lot. So
yeah, great example. If you just write those eight words on, or nine words, I guess, on a sticky note and put it by your computer, you should never have that problem again. And eventually you just start to do it automatically without referencing that. But that's a good tool to use starting out.
Exactly. Whoops. Let's get back to that.
There. All right, so I want to walk examples here. If you guys do have more questions, I think this will make it clear. Here's an example. This is on the pound dollar. It's a four-hour chart. Same type of thing, where we're seeing this bullish Marubozu candle, strong buying pressure. Then we get that pause, that inside candle. It doesn't really matter if this inside candle is green or red or what have you. This is actually an example that I think, now looking back at it, I might have had a bit of a wider stop, but it's the same idea where you're looking to buy. If we break above that high, you'll have to take my word for it that that's a 5 pip cushion above this bullish Marubozu candle high. As for the stop loss, I can't put myself in my mindset where I was when I outlined this trade, but according to our rules, that stop loss could actually be even tighter on the trade. It's currently set up here on 58.45, but you could probably set it up another 10 pips or so around 58.55 and still be below that inside candle low and have an even better risk to reward ratio up to the target, which was set, again, somewhat subjective. Maybe you want to use fibs or pivot points or GAN lines or something like that to determine support and resistance, but for a very basic way, you can just set up that target ahead of those previous resistance areas here at 59.50. You'll have 70 pips of reward at a maximum 35 pips of risk, so a 2-to-1 reward to risk ratio. And this is really what I feel like can make a strong opportunity, because it has both the probability that we know from determining where the momentum in the market is, and it also has the good reward to risk ratio. Now, as we'll see an example here, this trade didn't work out at all. But it shows why it's very important to honor your stop loss when using this. We identified the momentum was going to the top side. We just peaked to a new high, but then we quickly reversed. Well, yeah, that's frustrating as a trader, but notice what happened. We reversed, dropped down to our stop loss, in fact, within just about one or two candles, so pretty quick for this four-hour chart, and we're stopped out for a 35-pip loss or so on the trade, but the market kept dropping. This is why it's always important to use a tight stop loss, because if we see such a big shift in momentum, the whole reason we're trading this strategy is because the momentum's to the top side and we think there's a good chance it'll continue. It's likely that a lot of other traders got wrong-footed, caught on the wrong side of the market too, and we saw that actually we dropped at least 200 pips from our initial entry just in this 24-hour period alone. So this just goes to show that there are losing trades that happen, but the good part is that if we can get out quickly, we keep our losses limited, and as long as we can win 50% or more of the trades looking for good risk-to-reward ratio, we can come out on top in the long run. Yep, so question here from Deepak, does the inside candle have to be bearish? for this strategy, I haven't seen any difference regardless of whether that inside candle is bullish or bearish. I always just look for an inside candle. That shows us our pause. There is a little bit of a pullback in that candle regardless, but it doesn't really matter how it finishes, whether it's green or red, from my point of view. All right, so I wanted to walk through an example of a selling trade next. It's going to be almost the exact same rules, only reverse. So now we're looking for a bearish Marubozu candle. Again, this example will probably be on the 4-hour chart, but the same idea can be applied to a 1-hour or daily chart. The candle's range should be larger than the ATR. That shows that it's a bigger than average candle, showing strong selling pressure. Then we're waiting for at least one inside candle, regardless of the color, green or red, to form in the lower half of the Marubozu candle, indicating that the sellers are still in control. We're just seeing a pause in that selling pressure, and then just reverse the orders we used before. Now we get in again with the stop sell. If you reference that diagram you just made from Neil on your sticky note, you'll see that we want to sell below the market price, so that'd be a stop sell order 5 pips below that low, stop loss 5 pips above the inside candle high. Same idea here. And we're looking for a target at the next level of support where the market might find a bottom now. Again, looking for that 1-to-1 risk-to-reward ratio. So let's walk through a quick example here. This is a pretty volatile time. This was a chart here of gold, and I believe this is from a few months ago. So if you are trading gold, don't freak out and say, wow, I didn't realize gold was all the way back up at 1700, because it's not right now. But again, we're looking at this large bearish Marubozu candle, much bigger than some of the average candles we've seen. Strong selling pressure here. And then we saw two inside candles. So after this first one, you might have set up the trade looking to sell below this low. I used a little bit of latitude. This shows how you can adjust the strategy to each situation. So our rule, remember, was 5 pips. Maybe on gold, you want to look for 50 cents or something like that. But here, we identified these other lows in that same area. So there's a lot of support right here at, let's say, 1725 up to 1727. I only wanted to sell if that selling pressure was strong enough to break back through that floor. Still had a stop loss. Maybe after this first inside candle, you could have set up the trade with a stop loss right here above that high. But then that next candle came in, put in a little bit of a higher high, but it's still in the lower half. So it's still something I'd consider a valid trade. So eventually that stop loss would have ended up here at about 1735.5, giving us $11 of risk with a profit target down here. Again, this is probably the most straightforward example, just ahead of some of those support levels at 1712.5. And that's how you'd look to set up the trade.
Just a question on your inside candles here. Now, is there a rule as far as how big these inside candles take up the Marubozu candle? Like, do you look at the halfway point as far as saying, okay, well, this is still an inside candle, but the inside candle's taking up, let's say, 70% of the Marubozu candle. Would you still consider that a valid signal as far as getting into a trade? Or is there a limit somewhere along the lines where you say, okay, now this is too big, and now I won't get into this trade?
Right, and this I do follow closely here, and you were right there on the right track there, Neil, with the halfway point. That's why 50% of the candle, if you retrace more than that, that's kind of showing a balanced two-way market. The typical market will move in waves. We might see it go up $10, then down $6, then up $10, then down $6. That's not the type of market we're looking to capture. We're looking for getting in on a quick surge, something that often is completed in one or two candles on whatever time frame you're looking at. So we want to see that in the example of a sell trade, the sellers are staying in control. What I use is just the 50% line. So just eyeballing this candle, maybe this high is around, we'll just call it 1750 for the ease of the example, and the low we'll call around 1725. So that's a $25 candle in gold. If we go up $12 back into the middle point here at, say, 1737, so this is really getting right about to that halfway point. If we go above that level, it's not the type of setup we're looking for. It's not showing that strong selling pressure and then a brief pause, and it's not a trade that I'd be looking to take. So that's kind of a good rule of thumb here, and you can see this one probably went up maybe 35, 40%, but it is still a valid setup. And as we can see, we got a nice break lower, and within two candles, we'd gone down to our profit target. Actually, very volatile candle here where we dipped all the way down to 1700 and then recovered back to 1720. Regardless, our trade would have triggered here, resulting in a quick $12 win, I didn't mention it specifically, but it looks like this trade had $11 of risk compared to $12 of reward. So again, better than that 1-to-1 risk to reward ratio, and the probabilities did shine in our favor this time, and we were able to book a $12 profit on. All right, so any questions you guys have about this, please feel free to type them in. I actually got into the office today, was excited to do this presentation, and decided to look at the market to see whether there was anything currently happening with this stutter step trade, because it's not always coming up. If you look at different time frames, you can usually find a couple every day, depending on the time frame and the instruments you're looking at. But there's actually a really good example on both the dollar Swiss and the euro dollar on a daily basis right now today. So I want to outline those and just highlight how you could apply those examples. The inside candle that we're looking at in these examples is going to be today's candle. So we don't know whether it's going to, for instance, follow that rule that Neil was just asking about. We don't know if it will finish in the lower half of the big Marubozu candle, the big selling pressure we saw, for instance, in the euro dollar yesterday. But it's a good example, and maybe we can outline how you might want to put this trade into practice just upcoming today. So Bavik has a question here. The question is, so this is kind of a scalping strategy if the objectives are met. I hesitate to use the term scalping there, Bavik, because scalping has more of an implication for time frame. Usually if you're looking at a scalp trade, traders only expect to be in that for as little as 5 minutes and maybe up to an hour or two. But obviously, if you're trading off of this four-hour chart, you're probably going to be in the trade more than an hour or two. I like to think of it as more of a momentum-driven strategy. So it could be a scalping strategy. Maybe if you identify these types of setups on a 5 or 15-minute chart, then it could be a scalp. But on something like this four-hour or daily chart, I still am looking for this strategy to complete in, say, 1 to 5 or 6 candles. But it might take 1 to 6 days, for instance, if we're looking at a daily chart. So I think you're on the right track. I'd call it more of a momentum-driven strategy, but on a short-term time frame, you might call it a scalp, just because of that timing implication with the term scalping. Good question, though. And like I said, any more questions you guys have, please feel free to type those in. What I want to do, assuming I'm in the right spot here in this presentation, yeah, so I just want to quickly hop you over to my DealBook 360. You bear with me, I'm going to share my computer screen with you. And I just wanted to highlight an example right now emerging here on the euro dollar daily chart. So hopefully my screen's showing up all right for you. And we can see that on this daily chart, this is a bit of a stretch of an example here. Maybe it's not quite a valid Marubozu candle, but I still think it shows good selling pressure. This is Friday's candle that I've circled here. It's a larger candle. The wicks are a little bit long, but notice how basically the price action is coming together. We got a non-farm payroll report on Friday, stronger than expected, led to U.S. dollar strength, or here weakness in the euro against the U.S. dollar. Big selling pressure. By the end of the day, we were just consolidating, and given the lack of data that Neil and I were talking about earlier, we see the market still consolidating around the 130 level. So it's certainly a big red candle, and now we're currently seeing a small inside candle. Whether or not you'd call this a Marubozu candle or not is somewhat in the air, but I still think the same principles can be applied that we saw that big selling pressure, now a pause. So maybe off of this daily chart, you could outline a similar strategy if you're someone who's comfortable holding on to trades for a couple of days or even a week. So just to apply that to the current market, we see that low that we put in on Friday is around 129.55. So let's just put our stop sell a bit below there. Let's just go 129.50 or so. So again, applying that 5 pip rule, I think it's still valid on the daily chart. That's going to be a stop sell because we're selling below the current market price. And the good part about the trade is that assuming the high that we put in so far holds, we can have a relatively tight stop loss relative to trading off of the daily chart. So the high right now of the inside candle is at 130.24. If we add in a 5 pip cushion there, we could be up at 130.30 or so. I guess that's a 6 pip cushion, but trading on a daily chart, a pip here or there isn't going to make a big difference. So we have 80 pips of risk, but relative to some of these larger candles we see and the fact that we're trading on a daily basis, that's still going to be a relatively low amount of risk, because for the profit target, and I'm just going to zoom back here, you can see the euro's at a pretty significant low, the lowest price it's been in so far in 2013. maybe the next level of support I'm tracking is some of these lows right around here from back in December and November of last year. Those come in around 28.75. So if we just look to take our profit ahead of that area, say at 28.80 on this trade, and this is where walking through your examples in advance would probably be valid, but it's still going to be a learning lesson if you guys can see where I'm coming from here. So if we were to set our profit target there above that next level of support, you'll notice that that puts that profit target there at 28.80. However, that area is only 70 pips from our entry. So in this example, we had what I called a small amount of risk for a daily chart, 80 pips. But given where the next support level is, that support level's about 70 pips below where we'd be selling. So the risk to reward ratio, we only stand to gain 70 pips if the trade works out, but we can lose 80 if it doesn't work out, really doesn't work in this example. So the price action was supportive, but maybe that's an example of what we talked about earlier, where I'd probably look to pass on this trade just because it's a higher probability trade, but we need it to be higher probability to be successful because of the relatively weak ratio. So it's an example here. I should have probably priced it out a little bit beforehand and seen whether the risk-to-reward ratio actually worked. But if I can just maybe adapt this, another thing I noticed... Did you have a question there, Neil? Or?
No, I didn't.
Okay. So the other thing I noticed is that we're looking at a very similar setup, U.S. dollar versus the Swiss franc, only in reverse. So if I pull up this daily chart of the dollar-Swiss, not surprising, the euro and the dollar-Swiss tend to move inversely. But again, we're seeing a bullish Marubozu candle. So now we're looking at a potential buy trade that formed on Friday. We're currently forming an inside candle in the upper half. So if I can just quickly walk through this example, we could look to buy if we break out above this high. The high that we put in on Friday is at 95.52. Yeah, I was looking at that. For those of you who aren't in this room with us, which is everyone, Neil pointed out that currently on the pound dollar 4-hour chart, I believe, it could be forming up. The thing you want to look for with this strategy, though, is that a lot of trades look like they could turn into a stutter step trade. But if we notice when the 4-hour candles begin and end, we just went through the time switch, Neil, so if you could reference that for me, that 4-hour candle that we currently see forming began about an hour ago. So it's still got 3 hours to go. So that could be a valid candle as well. But I think this daily chart candle might be a more valid signal just because it's about 2/3 complete, whereas that 4-hour candle is just getting started. But if you are looking for another principle, maybe keep an eye on the pound dollar 4-hour chart as well right now. Yeah, the next level of support, if we look at it in the pound dollar, which I'm looking at off screen, is quite a ways away because it's at 3-year lows. So just rotating back here to the dollar Swiss, we'd be looking to buy if we broke out above Friday's high, so that'd be a stop buy at 95.60 potentially. Stop loss, I really like this stop loss below the current inside candle low, or below today's low so far, right below the 9500 and handle at, let me just adjust my chart a little bit more, at 94.95. So in this example, we have a little bit less risk, only 65 pips. Let's see if it works out with a run up to the next level of resistance. Here we started to see some highs come in. The most significant high that I see comes from back, actually all the way in August of last year of 2012. We put in a high up at 96.35. So this example, it might be close as well. If we want to take our profit a little bit ahead of that high around 96.35, maybe we put it at 96.30 and see if the risk to reward ratio works out in this case. Just eyeballing it, it's going to be very close. So if that's our target, then we're looking at 70 pips of reward compared to 65 pips of risk. So in this case, very similar type of price action, but I think the dollar Swiss represents a better example because it has more room to continue its trend before hitting the next level of, in this case, resistance, in the case of the euro dollar support. So perhaps this is a better opportunity, and in retrospect, I'm kind of glad that we had the opportunity to walk through one where the risk-reward ratio didn't quite work out, and we're able to find a similar example on the dollar-Swiss daily chart where it could work out. So as long as we keep holding above the halfway point of this candle, it still could be a valid trade. The risk-to-reward ratio might get adjusted if we drop a little bit, but this is definitely something to have on your radar screens and a way to practice that trading strategy that I just walked you through. So that pretty much wraps up everything that I wanted to cover. So at this point, I want to pass it back to Neil.
All right. Well, thank you, Matt, for providing us with your know-how with these different charts. And obviously, this is a little bit different than what I normally look at in these presentations. I look a little bit more based on what's going on news-wise and much quicker trades. You know, four-hour charts are not something I usually look at. So it's always good to get that different perspective and a different look at things for those who don't normally attend Matt's webinars. So thank you very much, Matt, for everything today.
My pleasure.
If you guys do have any additional questions outside of this presentation, you can always send us an email at mrtwebinars@gft4x.com, or you can reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Twitter is probably the most effective and quickest way of getting a hold of both Matt and myself. My Twitter handle is @FXExaminer. Matt's is @MWellerFX. If you guys want to get any updates on any of my trades that I placed throughout previous webinars or anything along those lines, which we only have one trade open from past webinars, it's the long dollar yen, which we've been in for a while, I will use the hashtag long and short of it for any updates on anything. Other than that, that's pretty much all I have. So I want to thank everybody for coming into the presentation today. Matt, I want to thank you once again for giving us your inside knowledge, and it's very helpful, and one of the things that hopefully we'll be able to take away from this presentation and hopefully be able to profit from moving forward. So thanks again.
My pleasure.
So thanks again, everybody. Hopefully we'll see you many more webinars to come, and as always, wish you the best of luck.